29 years ago, I met a character, and my life's never been the same ever since. And his name is Richard Guy, and we have a video about him that we're going to show you.
Come to this continent in 1965 after a somewhat checkered career in Singapore and in India. And I met Elwin Berlikamp at a combinatorics conference in Chapel Hill in 1966. And he said, "Oh, I used your paper with Cedric Smith to help me analyze the game of dots and boxes." And he said we should write a book on games. And I said, "Well, I know just the person who can help us out."
I'm not sure how interested I was at high school, but I read this paper by Richard Guy and Cedric Smith, which sort of told me about this theory, and the theory was by Grundy and Smith, PM Grundy. And it was about adding games up.
And Conway got interested in games and quite soon asked the question, "Well, what happens if the two players have a different set of moves?" The games that I was playing, the two players had the same set of moves. You know, it didn't cover Go or chess or anything really interesting looking. And Conway asked this question and as a result developed the Conway theory of games. And so that's how we got together on that. Martin was very, very modest, but he was obviously a very intelligent person, but he had no training in mathematics. And I think he needed to have things explained to him. And then, of course, as soon as they were, he caught on and was able to expose them himself and so on. But he often needed, and I think he sought this out by writing to people and getting their ideas on things. I'm not a very good correspondent, but I was surprised to find when I looked in my filing cabinets that I have quite an enormous amount of correspondence from Martin. He was a superb correspondent. He always answered and so on, and quite often he would write and ask me questions about the things that he was working on that he knew that I might be able to help him with the answers. When I have a problem, I like to draw a picture, you know, if I can find some. I have to see the problem. I can't just wrap a cold towel around my head and think. I have to actually have some, either some numbers or some pictures to work with. I like looking at sequences of numbers, and I like looking at actual diagrams. Of course, one of the many things that Conway and I have a common interest in is triangle geometry.
In August 2015, Richard Guy gave a remarkable talk on triangle geometry at the Second Moves Conference at the National Museum of Mathematics in New York City. He gave the talk a provocative title: "A triangle has eight vertices, but only one center." The orthocenter, he insisted, should have equal status with the three traditional vertices, and then he had four others in mind as well. He discussed quadrature, twinning, and extraversions of Conway's extraversion. John Conway was sitting in the front row and was heard to cry out, "That's beautiful, Richard. How often does that happen?" It was a bravado performance, and he ended it with an audience sing-along of "Bring back, bring back, bring back my geometry." On the last day of the conference, I shared a lift with him down to the street level, And I turned to him and said, Richard, you know, your talk on the first day was by far the best talk of the whole conference. And he looked up at me and he said, I thought so too.
Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for Richard Guy.
Well, that's a pleasant surprise. I'm afraid the talk is likely to be a considerable anticlimax after that. But nothing to do with the talk. I was reminded, a small story I should tell you, which goes back to nearly 20 years, when John Conway and I were writing the Book of Numbers, and we came to the Fermat numbers, which I'm sure you all know, the first five of them are prime, and many people believe there aren't any more after that. But there's still the problem of factoring these numbers, and we put in the book what was known about the factors of the Fermat numbers at that time, and John volunteered the information that he didn't think anyone would factor another Fermat number in the next 20 years. And I said, I'm sure they will. So this resulted in a bet. I bet that somebody would. So you've still got I suppose about 6 months left. And as a very generous gesture, I will share the $20 that that John will have to give me if somebody factors the thing. So get factoring and you can earn $10. I'm finished with the fun now. We can just do mathematics instead. As Leibniz has told us, from zero and one you can get anything. And of course he was talking about the binary notation that's fundamentally the thing behind computers now. But I want to use zero and one to get a lot of other things. We'll see if we can. There's zero, and there's one. Then I'm going to multiply the previous line by A and add in B, the B times the one before that. So A times one and B times nothing is just A. A times A is A squared and B times one is B. So we got that. And then A cubed plus AB, and then B times the line before gives another AB, so we've got two AB, and I think you cottoned on to the idea, and when you get home after the thing, you can go as far as you like. Now, I want you to put your head on one side. Unfortunately, because I'm facing you, so I shall put my head on the wrong side, I think. But well, let's see. Tip your head on one side. Right, there's one. So So, okay, you can tip it over this way, that's right. And, well, I expect most of you already recognize the pattern. You see the coefficients of form the leading tower of Pascal, but of course Pascal's triangle was known to the Japanese before the time of Pascal, and it was known to the Chinese before them, and in fact it was known to Omar Khayyam, who the author of the Rubaiyat, and in fact, it was known even earlier by Al-Karaji, and before that by Pingala, and Pingala sort of assassinates nicely with Pisa, so we have the Leaning Tower of Pingala. And that's... yeah, I pressed it too many times. Well, if you took take A equals 2 and B equals minus 1, well, you just get the natural numbers. Twice 1 is 2, twice 2 is 4, minus 1 is 3, twice 3 is 6, minus 2 is 4, and so on. So that's not awfully exciting. So if you try A equals 3 and B equals minus 2, you'll find that you get the Mersenne numbers. 3 times 1 is 3. 3 threes minus 2 ones is 7, 3 sevens is 21, minus 2 threes is 15, and so on. You get the Mersenne numbers, which of course are fairly notorious. I believe there's a new Mersenne prime was found just a few months ago. Everyone believes that infinitely many of these are prime, but no one has managed to prove that. If you try A equals 1 and B equals 1, then of course you're simply adding the two previous numbers, and the Fibonacci numbers, whole books have been written about those. A number of ways of packing dominoes in a 2x1 box. Right? So if n is 1, you just pack it back 0 dominoes in exactly one way. You pack one domino in a 1x2 box, and then 2, you can put them up vertically or horizontally. And 3, you see there are 3 ways of doing it. For 5, there are 5 ways of doing it. And from then on, you'd be likely to start missing out some of them or not counting them properly. But if you think for a moment, supposing we want to know 6, then every packing of dominoes into a 2x6 box at the right-hand end, there'll either be a vertical domino or there'll be 2 horizontal ones. So you'll get them all by adding a vertical domino to the 1x4s, there are 5 of those, or you can put 2 horizontal dominoes to the right of the 2x3s. 5 and 3 makes 8, and of course that goes on that way. If I try A equals 2 and B equals 1, then we get the so-called Pell numbers, but that's a, as with most things in mathematics, they're misnamed, and certainly go back to Brahmagupta. And they are, I believe that they were known to the Babylonians 4,000 years ago. And let's see if I can convince you of that. Because they're the denominators of good approximations to the square root of 2. Now, just suppose, incidentally, if you use the right notation, you could be as good at arithmetic as the Babylonians were, and use the scale of 60, which is very nice, because 60 is the LCM of 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6, so you don't get any awkward numbers when you're dealing with fairly small numbers. So, well, supposing you want to know, is there a number which, when you multiply it by itself, gives 2? And, well, you look at 1, and that's obviously too small. Then you look at 2, and that's obviously too big. So it must be something in between. And the obvious thing to try is 1.5, 3/2. And if you divide that into 2, it goes 4/3 times. And so 3/2 is too big, and 4/3 is too small. What we want is the geometric mean, not the arithmetic mean of these numbers. And I think anybody who starts thinking about this for a moment would immediately realize that the arithmetic mean is greater than the geometric mean. And I'm pretty sure that the Babylonians were intelligent enough to notice that. So, 3/2 too big, 4/3 too small. So what do? We take the average, which is 3/2 and 4/3 is 17/12. And again, if you divide that into 2, you get 24/17. And a little bit of arithmetic, you can convince yourself that 17/12 is bigger than 24/17. So our answer is going to be in between the two. If you take the average of 17/12 and 24/17, you get 577/408. And I think the Babylonians knew that, although they don't actually, as far as I know, that's not actually recorded, but they do give a value of square root of 2, which is better than that. So I think that they realized that not only were they close, but they were just close by a bit too much. And so you'll notice that the numbers that we've tried, 1 and 3/2 and 17/12 and 577/408, they're the first, second, fourth, and the eighth of these, which are, of course, the convergence to the continued fraction for the square root of 2. And well, that's what we've just been doing. that's where we are. And you notice, of course, that 3/2, that 3 squared is twice 2 squared, almost, but plus 1. 17 squared is twice 12 squared plus 1. 577 squared is twice 408 squared plus 1. So that, you see, there's no difficult arithmetic involved, and if you've got enough paper or if you've got enough clay tablets, you could have you could perhaps work out the next one. So the next thing you appreciate is that in some sense there is no number whose square is 2. You have to have some new kind of number, and I'm sure that the Babylonians realized this. In Babylonian, that's in base 60, square root of 2 is that. And 577 over 408 is that. So if you were writing it down to 3 Babylonian places, you see where are we? The 35 is more than half of 60. So if you were correcting it, you would put 11 there. But I think they knew that it was too big, and the clay tablet that has come down to us has actually got 10 in it. So you can see that they must have been fairly careful with their arithmetic. Right, well, let's go back to our Leaning Tower, and A equals 1, B equals 2 gives us the Jakobstahl numbers, which have some nice properties. One simple way of getting at them is instead of taking A equals 1, B equals 2, you just get the next one by double the previous one and then add or subtract one alternately. Twice 1 plus 1 is 3, twice 3 minus 1 is 5, twice 5 plus 1 is 11, twice 11 minus 1 is 21, and so on, plus, minus, plus, minus. Yes, well, those of you who read just over a year ago the December Mathematics magazine will already know this, I think, but Julian Salazar and Tanya Kovanova, who no doubt is somewhere hiding amongst you. And I wrote a paper about Conway's subprime Fibonacci sequences. When John Loss came to visit me in Calgary, he amused himself on the aircraft by modifying the Fibonacci sequence slightly by starting off in the usual way, 1, 1, 2, 3, 5. But when he came to 8, if it was a composite number, then to stop the numbers getting too big, he divided out by the smallest prime factor. So instead of 8, you put 4. Then 5 and 4 is 9, which is composite, so you divide out by the 3 and you get 3. And 3 and 4 makes 7, that's okay. 7 and 4 is 11. 11 and 7 is 18, so we have to divide out by 2 and get 9. And you keep going, you've got something now to fill in the time for the rest of this lecture. You can find out what happens. We don't know what happens, really, and the problems look suspicious. You can start with any pair of numbers, of course, not necessarily one and one. Tanya and Julian discovered that there were as many as half a dozen cycles that you might run into, just as in the 3x plus 1 problem, you're likely to run into the cycle 1, 4, 2, 1, 4, 2, and so on. But with these Conway numbers, there are as many as half a dozen different cycles, and we believe, as with the 3x plus 1 problem, that numbers always finish in one of these six cycles, but we can't prove it. We proved a certain amount of things, and these Jacob-style numbers were quite useful in analyzing that. And we can do some more kinds of tiling using the Jacob-style numbers. You could take a 3 by n minus 1 rectangle and try tiling it with squares of side 1 unit and squares of side 2 units, and you'll find that the numbers are in fact the Jacob-style numbers. Or you can try doing a 2 by n minus 1 rectangle as we did with the Fibonacci numbers, but in addition to dominoes, we allow 2 by 2 squares, and you'll find that you get the there's a short proof that these numbers are indeed the Jacob-style numbers, because in the first case, the writer, if you want to get the next of the numbers there, the right-hand end of your packing either ends in 3 unit squares or ends with a 2 by 2 square, which may be on top of two little ones or underneath it. And in the same way, you get a similar appearance for the second problem, which is the end is either a vertical domino or two horizontal ones or a 2 by 2 square, so that it satisfies those. Right, let's go back to the thing. Let's try, if you put A equals X and B equals minus 1, you get the Chebyshev polynomials of the first kind. Or if you put A equals 2X and B equals minus 1, then you get Chebyshev polynomials of the second kind, which crop up in a number of surprising ways in mathematics. They're the solutions of a second-order differential equation, and they're the convenient way of remembering your trig formulae. Right, well now let's go back to these polynomials that we've got. Go back to the original AB ones and factor them. And the ones I've drawn a wavy line underneath don't have any rational factors. They're sort of primitive parts of the polynomials, somewhat like the cyclotomic polynomials of the primitive parts of the factors of x to the n minus 1. And it illustrates that, in fact, all the sequences that we get in this way are divisibility sequences. That is, if m divides n, then the mth term divides the nth term. And it's fairly easy to see how to do that. We make a guess that the value of the nth term of the sequence is of the shape ax to the n. And you plug that in and cancel out x to the n minus 2 a day. You just get a quadratic equation, which many of you can solve. And so, of course, there are two roots. And since these are linear equations, any linear combination of the two roots will satisfy the equation. But so it's something like A alpha to the n plus B beta to the n. But I'm insisting that we start with 0 and 1. So that's enough to determine our coefficients A and B, big A and big B. So we arrive at what's often called Binet's formula, but again, as with everything else in mathematics, it's misnamed. You find Binet's formula in Euler's work, and in fact, it goes back at least to de Moivre. But anyhow, having got that, alpha, what do I? No, I don't. Well, you have to imagine it. It's easy now to see that U sub n will divide U sub m times n for any m and n, because difference of two composite powers is always divisible by any difference of divisors of those. So, what we'd like to know is where do the prime factors occur? Well, for the Fibonacci numbers, which will be the ones most familiar to you, the discriminant is 5. It's remember, A was 1 and B was 1 for the Fibonacci numbers. So B squared plus 4A is 5 in this case. And so the Lucas-Lehmer theory tells us that the nth term of the Fibonacci sequence is divisible by, I put it round the other way. If a prime is ends in 1 or 9, then it divides the p minus 1th term of the sequence, and if it ends in 3 or 7, it divides the p plus 1th member, and of course 5 itself being the discriminant is the law unto itself, and 5 divides every 5th member of the Fibonacci sequence, as you know.
You missed out 2. Mm-hmm. I said, you missed out
2,
but don't ignore me, please.
But unfortunately, this is very nice theory, but it still leaves the question unanswered. See, 13 ends in 3, so we know that the 13 plus 1th term is going to be divisible by 13. And in fact, and every 14th member of the Fibonacci sequence divides by 13. But in fact, 13 divides the 7th member. In fact, it is the 7th member of the sequence. So what we get is the Lucas-Lehmann theory tells us that the rank of apparition, the first time a prime appears as a factor of a member of any of these sequences, it's a divisor of p plus or minus 1, depending on the quadratic character of the discriminant. But we don't know which. Big unsolved problem. Here's something else we don't know. Of course, the member of a sequence can only be prime if n is prime, because if n is not prime, then of course the divisors will make it composite. But if p is prime, then up is not necessarily prime. So among the Fibonacci numbers, for example, you 3 is prime, so the 3rd term is prime, and 5 is prime, and 7 is prime, gives me 11, 13, 17, and so on. But when you get to 19, it's not prime. And in fact, we don't know if there are infinitely many Fibonacci primes. I think most people believe that there are, but there's another nice unsolved problem for you. The same way, we don't know if there are infinitely many Mersenne primes. I mean, most people believe there are, but it seems to be beyond our capabilities at the moment. There are infinitely many Brahmagupta-Pell primes, or infinitely many Jacobstall primes. So plenty of unsolved problems for you. There are infinitely many things we don't know. But there are infinitely many things we do know, and that's the beauty of mathematics.